Well, thank you so much for having me. I'd like to thank Professor Gray especially for giving me this chance to talk to you, and for Greenfield Community College for hosting, and for all of you for coming today. As Professor Gray said, I started off at community colleges at a community college called Cypress College in Southern California, which is right next to Anaheim. And so I feel I'm coming back to my roots. I spoke at Holyoke as well, and so I'm really glad to be here and to share a little bit of my thoughts on the Syrian Revolution with you. There's a lot that can be said about the Syrian Revolution. There's a lot that can be said in terms of a background of the grievances beyond the revolt or for the revolt, what's going on right now, and what has taken place in the last 6 months. So I'd like to give you a flavor of that focus on three points. First is basically how life was in Syria before the revolt, which I'm not going to go into too much, but I'll sort of mention a little bit of that so you can get a feel of how life has changed since the revolt. So that's the first point. Second, what was taking place in the last 6 months. And finally, I'm going to end with a discussion of what is taking place right now and what are some of the obstacles and the difficulties that are confronting the Syrian people, that are confronting the protesters and the opposition groups in order to successfully carry out the revolt and to sort of end the bloodshed as well by the government. So I'd like to touch on these three points. Of course, feel free to stop me at any time, but I'll also leave plenty of time at the end of my talk for discussion and questions. So if you think of questions later, we can bring them up as well, and perhaps talk about more the current situation. So I want to start off by trying to lay out exactly why and how the revolt started in Syria by telling you a story of an incident that took place in Daraa, which is a city in the south of Syria, which was considered the spark for the revolts. You know that there were revolts that, and uprisings that were taking place in Egypt and Tunisia, and that the Syrian revolts were very much influenced by or inspired by these uprisings that were taking place throughout the Middle East. However, many people felt that perhaps Syria was too authoritarian, the government was too repressive, that people wouldn't go out. But actually, people started going out in very small groups, and the first chants, the first slogans that were being said were "Ashab Suri ma binzal," which means the Syrian people cannot be humiliated. The Syrian people should not be humiliated. The first chants that were actually being shouted in the streets were not for democracy, were not for freedom. They were just a cry against the repressive apparatus, against the security presence, against the intelligence, secret service, the spies, who were a constant presence or a daily presence in many Syrians' lives. They were such sort of an oppressive force that for many ordinary people, they had to try to navigate their daily life in a way that steered clear of someone sort of interfering with it. And this didn't just have to do with people who were political. I mean, we tend to think that dictatorships and authoritarian regimes, you know, oppress those who express dissent. But in fact, this is not the case. In many of these authoritarian regimes, it's ordinary people who are non-political, shopkeepers, taxi drivers, farmers, who have to try to navigate their daily life in a way that keeps these security forces off their back, because many of them want bribes, many of them want to tell them what to do. And so living in an authoritarian regime is a sort of a daily struggle. Again, not for everyone. Usually the wealthier you are, like in many places, the more you can afford to ignore these things, or the less harm that will be inflicted on you. But in many cases, for the poor of Syria, it was a difficult struggle. So the initial demonstrations with the slogan of "the Syrian people cannot be humiliated" weren't actually in Damascus, in the capital city, which is where I spent most of the time in July. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a second. But the incident which sparked the massive demonstrations started in Daraa, in the city in the south, which is right next to the Jordanian border. And it's a very difficult story to tell, because it's rather offensive to the sensibilities even now as I tell it, but it should be told to see the kind of humiliation that was faced by ordinary people in Syria. What had happened was that a group of school children, small teenagers, people in 10, 11, 12 year old, had been inspired by the slogans of "the people want to topple the regime," which they heard in Egypt, "Ash-Shab yurid isqat al-Nizam." And so they took some spray cans and they sprayed that slogan on a wall. These school children were caught by the security forces, beaten up, and had their fingernails sort of snapped off. They were then returned to their families in, you know, they were after the security forces had been done with them, you know, severely beaten and so forth. The men, their parents as well as some other people went to meet the governor to complain about the heavy-handed response of the security apparatus to what was just a, you know, school children prank. They were then met with even worse contempt. The governor basically told the parents, told these men, these group of elders who had gone to see him, to shut up, to just be happy their children weren't dead. And they told him, well, they could have died the way you beat them up. So his response was, and this is what sort of sparked even greater outrage, well, even if they die, send me your wives and I'll impregnate them for you and you'll get more children and you'll forget about those. I mean, this is the kind of humiliation and condescending attitude that many of these people were facing by a governor. So this incident, this response really sparked the mass demonstrations in Daraa, and the people were just outraged and they took to the streets repeating the slogan, "The Syrian people cannot be humiliated, they should not be humiliated." And this is an important thing to understand about the uprising in Syria, as well as the uprisings throughout the rest of the Arab world, is that there are economic grievances, there are political grievances, there are social grievances that many of the people are facing, but at its basis, it's a fight for dignity and self-worth. That people want to live full lives without having to face this daily humiliation. People don't like to be told what to do, to be treated like children, to be treated like they're less than full human beings. And this idea of dignity and self-worth is important to understanding the struggles of the Arabs in these regimes, as well as people throughout the world. People want respect, whether it's in the US or elsewhere around the world. They face different conditions and more difficult conditions in the Arab world, but it's at its essence this struggle for self-worth. So the demonstration started in Daraa. They were met with incredible violence, live ammunition. And then this didn't obviously succeed in preventing these people from coming out. More people joined the protests. There were more deaths. Then there was a spiral of force used by the government, and that force prompted more and more people to take to the streets. The government at that time had thought that the biggest mistake that Mubarak had made and that Ben Ali had made in Tunisia and Egypt, the lesson they learned, that is, the lesson that the Syrian government learned from Egypt and Tunisia, was that Mubarak and Ben Ali did not use sufficient violence, that if they had used overwhelming violence to nip the protests in the bud, they would have succeeded in crushing them. That's what they thought. Of course, they were mistaken, and they tried to use this strong violence, this overwhelming violence. They sent tanks to the cities, and again, these are tanks being sent to Syrian cities to face nonviolent, peaceful demonstrators. And the idea of sending the tanks was just that, to demonstrate that this is an overwhelming presence of the state, of the security apparatus, that this is what you're going to go up against. Just seeing a tank is enough to send this sort of psychological feeling of fear and terror that this is what you're going to have to face. It didn't succeed, and not only did it not succeed, but many people from throughout Syria started joining the protests. And from March 15th, which is the date that is given to the start of the big protests in Syria, until now, the government and the protesters throughout Syria, throughout most of Syria, and I'll lay out a little bit where most of the protests are, has been going through this spiral of the government laying siege to one city, sending tanks, sending soldiers, killing people, pacifying it momentarily, but then while they're there, another city goes up in rebellion. Then they go to put down that second city, the first city comes back in rebellion. Basically, most of the Syrian people, in their minds, the government has lost its legitimacy. So no matter how much violence the government uses, it can succeed in quelling them momentarily, but in the end, they're not going to put up with the government. Now, this started in March, and I was at Hampshire College in March, April, May. I was hoping to go to Syria as quickly as I could in order to see firsthand what was happening inside the country. And I wanted to go for several reasons. First, the government had banned any independent or foreign media from operating inside the country. So unlike the case of Egypt, you had no foreign media, no independent media, no even Arab media such as Al Jazeera. All of them were kicked out of the country. So it is very difficult to get accurate information. The only information that people were getting at the time that was not based on the government media itself, which was completely controlled by the government, was through YouTube and Twitter and activists trying on their own to film and document what was taking place and send it to the outside. And this is a really interesting thing to think about and perhaps to research. The fact that in the Syrian Revolution, more so than any other of the revolts taking place, it really completely and overwhelmingly depended on the new social media such as Facebook and Twitter to actually get the message across, because there was no television, there was no other sources of information. The second source, the second reason why I went to Syria is because my own family and friends were split on whether or not to support the protests. And people that I loved and that I trusted and that I spent my whole life talking to and being very close to were sharply divided on whether or not the protests were a good thing or a bad thing for the country. And so I, for the first time maybe in my life, even though I always claim that I really want to know all sides of a situation, I sort of do, but sometimes we sort of say that and we don't really take it meaningfully. In this case, because this was such a pivotal moment in the history of the country, I really wanted to find out what was happening firsthand. You know, I thought maybe it's a possibility that what the government is saying is true. Maybe it is just a conspiracy against Syria. Maybe everyone is just blowing things out of proportion. Because I was hearing people that I loved say that. And so I was really in a difficult moment, especially writing on Facebook. I was attacked by many of my friends saying, look, you have no idea what you're talking about. You're sitting in your comfortable life in Hampshire and you're a professor in the US. You have no clue. You should just be quiet and let us handle the situation. And basically, these protesters are not good for the country. These protests are not good. We don't know who they are. They're shady characters and so forth. So I sort of really wanted to find out for myself what took place. So in July, I traveled to Syria. And I first went to Lebanon, to Beirut, stayed a few days in Beirut. And I crossed through the land border from Beirut to Damascus. The reason I flew into Beirut was because when I booked my plane ticket, I was afraid that by the time my flight actually arrived, the airport might have been closed, the Damascus airport. So I wanted to at least get to Lebanon and find some way to get into the country in case the airports had been closed. And I spent most of my time in Damascus and the surrounding regions of Damascus. And I took a trip to Hama, which is a town in the center of Syria, which is right here. That's Hama, on the Orontes River. And I'll talk a little bit about my experience in Damascus and also in Hama. So life in Damascus was really interesting. By the time I entered, which was in July, the uprisings had spread throughout most of the periphery of Syria. Meaning, if you look at the map of Syria, There were uprisings in Daraa in the south. There were uprisings in the northern areas. And there were uprisings in the northeast. But the two big cities, which are Damascus, the capital city, and Aleppo, which is the second biggest city and a commercial and industrial hub in the country, the two most important cities had not seen the massive uprisings or the mass demonstrations that you saw elsewhere. Hamas, which is another town, which is actually the town that my family is originally from. I was born and raised in the capital city in Damascus, but my family is originally my family comes from a small village just south of Hamas. We're a sort of a farming family originally. And we had moved to, my grandfather had moved to Damascus. Hamas was interesting because it had seen mass demonstrations which had occupied the main square of Hamas called the clock square, because at the center of the square there's a big clock. And there was an attempt to set up something similar to the Tahrir square in Egypt, except the difference, and this sort of illustrates the difference in the response, there was overwhelming violence, live ammunition, and sort of a massacre that took place by the government that cleared out by force everyone in the square. So, Damascus itself, as I mentioned, didn't have the level of demonstrations that was there elsewhere. And there was a very weird sense of normalcy that was happening in the city, in the sense that life appeared to be normal, everything was fine, but in fact you could see security presence everywhere. And what the regime was doing was that it was sending buses, empty buses, throughout the city, roaming the city, 24 hours a day, and looking for demonstrators. So if there was a flash demonstration somewhere, they would send lots of security, lots of soldiers to that area, surround the demonstrators, hoard them off into the buses, and then take them to detention centers. And the government had been trying its best not to be violent on the streets of Damascus. Since there were so many people in Damascus, around 3 or 4 million people live in Damascus out of a 20 million population in entire Syria. Since a big chunk of people live in Damascus, it was important for the regime to try and be very, very decisive in its rounding up of the protesters, but not to use live ammunition there, because it was trying to create the impression that all the stories about live ammunition were false. So the very weird thing that I saw in Damascus, in the capital city, was that there were many people in Damascus who had no idea what was happening in the rest of the country, because there were no media coverage, there were no real possibility of traveling there. They didn't want to travel there. And so they really were clueless about what was happening in Hama. And for many people, it was easy for them, and this goes to the people who were against the protest that I just mentioned, many of my friends and family members, it was easy for them to believe the story of the regime. It was easy for them to say, to think that, there's nothing happening in Damascus, and there's nobody out on the street, and so it must be that those people up in the north or in Daraa, they're just lying or they're just fabricating it. So there was a strange split, and there's a strange split in Syria, which is very bizarre, which is that the people who had decided from the beginning of the protests that they were against them, that they were not good for the country, then decided that they're going to believe all the stories that the government was saying. And the people who had been sympathetic to the protests, the people who had thought that this is unacceptable what the regime is doing, were the ones who were talking about this stuff. So it was a very weird situation. Now, having said that, despite the fact that there weren't mass demonstrations, there were in fact demonstrations happening in the city and around the city in particular. So there were two main neighborhoods that saw demonstrations every Friday after the Friday prayers. And I went several times to those neighborhoods, and what the regime would do was to completely cordon off that entire neighborhood. from the rest of the city so that nobody can get in and out. In a couple occasions, I actually managed to get in. By the time I got to where I thought the demonstration might be, everyone had been arrested already. And you would hear later on stories of what happened to those people. So there were these attempts by people to start increasing the demonstrations in Damascus. And as the situation stands now, it's still this cat and mouse game is still going on between the demonstrators and the regime inside Damascus. But what had happened was that since March 15th, the regime has arrested perhaps tens of thousands of people. We actually don't know how many people they arrested. So even though they have killed a lot of people, maybe 3,000, that's maybe a conservative estimate of 3,000 people, which is a lot in a 20 million country. Their main tactic by the regime has been to arrest people and sort of get them out of the streets, especially people who were identified as organizers or people who were basically active in organizing the demonstrations. And the organization of the demonstration has been very difficult, given the fact that there are government spies everywhere, and given the fact that there's heavy repression. The organization is happening at the neighborhood level with people that you trust the most. I just found out today that the US has 16 intelligence agencies, according to Wikipedia, which I don't suggest is a good research source. But I wanted to make some comparison, so I went on and searched for, you know, US intelligence agencies and found there were 16. Don't hold me to this. Maybe there's less. I don't
know.
Probably
many more.
Maybe there's many more, right. So that's a country of 300 million. Syria has 13 or 14 intelligence agencies in a country of 20 million. And many of these agencies, they have a network of spies and informants who actually don't know each other. So in a tip before the demonstrations took place, they would be very effective because, you know, if we would be sitting in a room such as this and I happen to speak something against the regime or against the president, and some of the people in attendance were informants, they would have to report it. They'd have to report for several reasons. First, it's their job to do so, okay? But even if they didn't want to, even if Carol thought, you know what, I really don't want to report on Omar because he's a nice guy and maybe he didn't mean this, she would report it because someone else might be a spy for a different agency. And they would report it and they'd write that Carol was there. And if a report wasn't filed by Carol, then that agency would say, hey, why aren't you, you were there, why didn't you say anything? So to save yourself, you would file the report. That's when, you know, that's how authoritarian regimes work. That's how they have this multiplicity of spy networks. And that was really effective in stifling dissent. So in order to circumvent that, the organizing was happening on a local level, on a neighborhood level, and then networking out from those. And the organizations that are the main backbone of the revolution are called the local coordination committees. And they're the ones that are starting at the neighborhood level, the LCCs, and really carrying the burden of the revolt. They're the ones who are going out in the demonstrations every Friday or in some places every day. They're the ones who are suffering the brutality of the regime, but they're really the ones who are the moving spirit, the moving force of the revolt. And the tactics that have been used have been varied. There are demonstrations, but since there's repression, as I mentioned, there are sometimes, instead of just a mass demonstration, there are flash or guerrilla demonstrations where people would go out, demonstrate for a few minutes, put out their signs, and then withdraw before the police showed up. A very interesting demonstration which took place inside Damascus, which was a very unorthodox type of sort of initiative, was called the White Shirts demonstration, which is basically a group of 400 or more people would all agree to wear white, and they would walk around in this commercial district. They wouldn't say anything, they wouldn't talk to each other, they wouldn't even be in groups of more than two. They would just walk back and forth all day, signaling that, you know, there's something going on. But the security apparatus would, you know, stand there baffled by what the heck is going on there, and they wouldn't have any pretext to arrest them. So there were all sorts of ways that they were resisting, symbolically, in demonstrations, in slogans, on Facebook. There were many ways in which people were putting out the message of resistance, because it was important to keep putting out this message so that other people will take heart and realize that they're not alone. Even if it's just a slogan written on a wall, it makes a big difference. If you are living in a climate of fear and you feel like you're the only one speaking out, if you see that there's someone else contributing, even if it's a small thing, it makes a big difference. And I think it's important to keep that in mind, because that's true everywhere, not just in Syria. When you're trying to build a movement for social justice, it's important to do anything, even if it's symbolic, to sort of let people know that you're actually out there and that you're fighting for something. So that's Damascus. In the middle of July, I took a trip, towards the end of July, I took a trip to Hama. And
how big was that? How big a city is that?
It's 1 million people. Okay. So it's not huge, but it's not very small either. Yeah, 900,000 to 1 million. And Hama was a city that had suffered repeatedly the brutality of the regime. Since the 60s, there were demonstrations against the regime, and since the 60s, they were put down violently, culminating in 1982 of a brutal crackdown against an insurgency against this regime. It was the father of this current president. And this insurgency at that time had started out being an opposition by many people in Syrian society, but it ended up being the Muslim Brotherhood, Islamist party, who fought the regime and who hunkered down in Hama as sort of taking a last stand at the end of a sort of several years of conflict. The response of the regime was basically to destroy the city and kill lots of people. There are estimates of 10 to 30 or 40,000 people who died over a span of a month. They were fighting the Muslim Brotherhood, but they didn't discriminate. They killed many, many people. So the city in its own mind has a history of resistance, but also a history of suffering more so than any other cities at the hand of the regime. And it had stayed silent, meaning there weren't that many demonstrations, you know, March 15th up to April 15th, or beyond that, up until late April. You know, Hama wasn't demonstrating, and people were saying, what, is Hama too scared? What's going on? Why aren't the people demonstrating? And then, as with Dara, a small incident lit the spark. Finally, some people decided to organize, and they had a bunch of, a large group of people went out in a peaceful demonstration. They weren't shouting any slogans, and there were a group of children carrying flowers at sort of the front of the demonstration. They went to the Ba'ath Party headquarters, soldiers opened fire, killed people. The following day, Hama went up in mass. But Hama, more so than any other city, the entire city went out. So of 1 million people, 500,000-600,000 people were demonstrating, which is basically the entire city. I mean, there are people who are just incapable of going out to the street, and there are very small children and very elderly who couldn't go out. So it's essentially the entire city. And the response of the regime, they were so overwhelmed that all security apparatus left the city. So the city, when I traveled to it, was liberated and was run by its own residents. Okay, and it was really an extraordinary experience to be there. I told my wife when I got back, she asked me about what struck me most from the visit, and I really told her that my time spent in Hama, the couple days I spent in Hama, was the time that I felt the most free in my life, because I had never been in any city that was completely run by its own people. There were no cops, there were no security presence, it was just the people of the city running their daily lives. And what they had done was they had found ways to organize all the different aspects of daily life that would be normally run by the state. And most visible to me at that time was traffic. So they had volunteers, teenagers, manning checkpoints, 4 or 5 people at a time, directing traffic, and it was very harsh conditioning. The summers in the Middle East are very oppressive and blisteringly hot. So these children, these teenagers, were sitting all day under the sun directing traffic and making sure things were flowing as normal. Markets were open as normal. There, it was busy streets. And towards the end of the night, after the evening prayers, all the people would gather in a mass demonstrations in the biggest square in the city. And I'd like to show you a few pictures from my time in Hama, just to illustrate some of the things that were going on in the city. So the first one is these Roman norias, and they are these massive water wheels. I don't know if you, you've seen them before or know about them, but they were 2,000-year-old agricultural devices that more or less still work in their intended purpose. They were built by the Romans to irrigate central Syria, and basically the river would flow and would make this giant water wheel turn and take through pots or through wooden buckets, would take water up to aqueducts that would flow towards the center of the city. This is what Hama is famous for, and this is one of its sort of more well-known landmarks, and I'll show you a slide video on that in a second. So what the people of the city had done was they had put up barricades throughout the city to try and prevent or slow down an attack that may be launched by the regime. So throughout the city, you saw these makeshift barriers, tires, cinder blocks, and so forth, that they would close if they felt that an attack may happen. Now, of course, the government was sending in tanks, so these barriers were not going to slow down tanks, really. But they were there, first, I felt they were there for a sort of psychological feeling of safety that the people had, but also to try and slow down, perhaps, a government attack. And these were spread throughout the city, so you saw things like that. Some roads would be closed off completely. Some roads were not closed off, but they were sort of these other barriers. I took this picture because throughout my time in Damascus, many of the people I spoke with were getting the impression that the insurgency was this really radical Islamist, very conservative uprising, and that once the people who represented the opposition would come to power, they would, ban. They would impose a very hardline Islamist lifestyle on the population. And Hama was completely liberated by its people, and yet, you know, all the liquor stores were open. So this was in the Christian, this was in the Christian quarter, and I sort of took this picture just to show my friends in Damascus that, no, look, even, you know, you can actually buy alcohol in Hama, you know, don't worry. things are going to be fine, you know. This was the main square in Hama, and this is not a great picture, but this is the sort of the tower in the middle of the square right here. And this is basically a huge area that would be filled every night with several hundred thousand protesters. After the evening's prayers, as I mentioned, the streets would be blocked off, and people would gather to demonstrate. This picture was taken from a cafe, and the reason I took this picture is because where I sat, where I was taking the picture from, was this huge cafe along the banks of the river. And it was very strange to me that in this old part of town there would be just this modern cafe. And I asked, why is this cafe here? Well, it turns out that where I was taking the picture from was known as the Keylaniye district, which was one of the most historic architectural sites in Syria. And during the 1982 uprising, some of the last insurgents had taken refuge in this area, thinking the government would never destroy such a historic site. It's sort of like, you know, taking refuge in the capital or something like that. Well, the government bombed it anyway and destroyed this whole quarter. So this is very close to the big square where the demonstrations were. So there's a sort of constant reminder of the battles that the Hamwis had fought with the city. So this is a very poor picture of the nightly demonstrations. This is the tower that I showed you earlier, and this is the big square, which would be completely full by 9, 10 o'clock at night. By midnight, People were still there beyond midnight, 1, 2 a.m. People were chanting. They were chanting against the regime. They were chanting in solidarity with other cities that had come under government attacks. They were also using it as a space to run their daily lives. So when I was there, there were some people who were saying, look, you need to slow down and ease down on the checkpoints because they're becoming a burden for the population and they're becoming a hassle. So we need to, you know, make traffic flow a little bit more smoothly. They were talking about the high school exam that many students had to take at the time. So it was a social gathering and a space for the people to actually talk about the daily events and to plan what they're going to do next and to think about sort of their political future. And I have two short videos to show you. One of them is about the water wheel itself, and its distinct sound. So to me, this sounded very annoying, but it was real music for the ears of all the Hamwis. In fact, they had gotten so used to it that they could distinguish which water wheel was which from their different sounds. And again, they take a lot of pride in this sort of historic symbol of the city. The second is some chants that were, oh, this is another one. I won't play this. I'll play the chants. And again, this is a very poor video because I took my really small old camera because I was afraid I'd be searched going in and out of the city. I wasn't, but just in case, I took my small one. So this was just the type of a flavor of what would take place at night. Okay, so this looks even darker there as it does here, so I'll stop it there. But basically, it's that's a good question. The main chant was what he just said, which is Ya mahlaha al-hurriya, oh how beautiful freedom is. And that was really the sort of the main inspiring chant that you could hear throughout these protests, just the feeling of freedom that people had for the first time in their lives. And in fact, during the day, even before the nightly demonstrations, during the day, when we were walking through the streets with the local person that was guiding me and was showing me where to go, you know, we would pass by a group of people and they would chant "Ya mahlaha al-hurriya," sort of like just like murmur underneath their breath as we were passing by. So it was really inspiring. A few days after I left Hama, the regime did attack the city and recapture it and killed a lot of people. I was actually very lucky and fortunate to get out of there when I did. It was just happenstance. I didn't even know what was going to happen. But I think unlike the case of 1982, the regime is not going to get away with this repeated crushing of the city because the city is still defiant and other cities have taken up the call. So the last thing I'm going to hit on is basically what's happening right now and some of the difficulties facing the Syrian revolt at the moment. In many ways, the reasons, the grievances that the people had, the reason they went to the streets is very simple. It's demonstrations against an authoritarian regime. However, the complications of the Syrian revolt have to do with a lot of things that are beyond that. One of them is the international geopolitical situation, where you have Russia and China and the US, as they've done elsewhere, playing a geopolitical game, where, in my view, the interests of the people, human rights, is not the main priority. And in many ways, the Syrian people, as other people throughout the region, perhaps the world, has suffered as a result of these different great powers trying to advance their own interests in many ways. The second main obstacle is the fact that internally, Syrian society is not homogeneous in some ways. And the government has been cleverly manipulating sectarian and ethnic differences to make, for example, some minorities feel that if they are overthrown, there would be a big disaster. And the people of Syria have been traumatized by what they saw in Iraq, where there was ethnic cleansing after the fall of the regime. There was ethnic conflict. And there were massive amounts of refugees that came into Syria. There are, until now, over a million Iraqi refugees in Syria that nobody actually talks about or mentions. And they're living under difficult situations. So Syrians have seen firsthand what the impact of a sort of a societal collapse is. Now, you can say many things in response to that, but to them, to many people who have grown up with stability, the devil you know is better than the devil you don't know. And that explains, going back to the people who were against the protest, many of them really feel that, look, we're afraid of the unknown. We're not going to pitch our wagon to some movement that could lead this country to destruction. And that's very powerful. That's a very, you know, fear of the unknown is very powerful. Fear of chaos is a strong deterrent for people joining the protest. So I think in many ways that plays into the hands of the regime. The regime knows the geopolitical game. The regime knows the internal struggles and the internal differences and has been manipulating that to the extreme. However, I feel that in many ways the opposition is getting more unified. And when the opposition gets more unified into forming a structure that people can see and many people can trust, they're more likely to side with them and to trust them and to join the protests. So right now we're still in a sort of stalemate between the opposition unable to really topple the regime and at the same time, thankfully, the regime unable to crush the protests. And there are many signs of worry. There are many signs that there's increasing violence, that there's increasing sectarian tensions, but there's also many signs of hope. And not least of which is that even today there were demonstrations going out criticizing Russia and China for their veto of the UN resolution. And I'll stop there and take any questions. Thank you.